From the Hill Country in Texas, this is OneRadioNetwork.com.
Talk to Patrick now, 888-663-6386, or email patrick@OneRadioNetwork.com.
Okay, here we go, hour two of our little show, and Stephen Heuer is here, and he's going to show up once a month or so until he tires of us, and then he'll just set us aside. Just kidding. Synergistic nutrition guy. It's the third Monday of the month. Next Monday would be Dr. Jennifer Daniels. She's down in Panama. And then the first Monday of the month is Adam Bergstrom. Second Monday is Tony Pantelaresco. Patrick Timpone, OneRadioNetwork.com. If you'd like to be on the show, you can do it. 888-663-6386. Email patrick@OneRadioNetwork.com. Let's take another call here. Good morning. What's your first name and where are you calling from?
Good morning, Patrick and Stephen. This is Amico from Colorado.
Amico from Colorado. Hi, Amico.
Hi.
Hi.
I was calling in regards to the One World Whey. I'm not sure how this plays into it, but I am casein intolerant. So with the One World Whey, I know you said in the past that
it has no casein. There's no casein in One World Whey. So the process of getting the whey made actually removes all the casein. So you don't have to worry about that. People with dairy intolerances, casein intolerances, take this and they have no problem. But we never had a problem person complain thus far.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so what do you know about, the other product that Patrick was talking about, the colostrum?
It's full of immunoglobulins and growth factors so that it really supports the immune system of the body. I mean, one of the things about the immune system of the body is that when it's freed up to do its job of your body, it can remodel. Your body, when you have a strong immune system, it can remodel cells and restore structural integrity to your body. It's just phenomenal. But normally that's not possible because the immune system is not freed up enough. It's too preoccupied with detoxification and fighting off different kinds of infections and stuff that are going on. So if you take anything that supports the immune system, such as colostrum, that's a fantastic food. And to do that, and you're also getting some growth factors, although I've not seen too much empirical results, actual real-world results of people reporting things, injuries or joints or different things repairing because of the growth factors in it. So I don't know how much, even though the proteins are there for the repair, the actual translation of your body absorbing those and using them, I haven't seen much empirical evidence on that. But as far as immune system stuff, colostrum's awesome.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
You're quite welcome. You're quite welcome. Thanks, Stephen. 888-663-6386. Stephen, somebody just sent me an article from Mercola that says early death comes from drinking distilled water.
That was from Mercola?
I think so. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of opinions out there, but when you study what's actually happening to people, and you have 60, 70 years of actual real-world results on thousands and thousands of people documented, then that kind of is meaningless at that point.
Oh, actually, it wasn't written by Mercola. It was written by a Dr. Rona, Zoltan Rona, whatever. Okay. Well, just like belly buttons, there's a lot of opinions around there. Some are innies and some are outies. You just get to pick which one you want. That's right. I think I want an innie. Okay. Let's see. Stephen Patrick from Linda, can you explain the difference between the liquid min, colloidal minerals, and mineral magic? I've been taking liquid min.
Liquid min and mineral magic are very similar, except that the liquid min is going to be, it has first gone through an acid bath, some kind of a sulfuric or hydrochloric acid bath to make more soluble the minerals and suspend them in a liquid state. And it's one way to take it. It's no problem. They're both pretty similar. I I like the convenience personally of the powder, and I think I've had more of an effect from the powdered mineral magic personally over the years. I've taken both, but I think I feel more from the mineral magic than the liquid min.
I've been doing mineral magic for, oh gosh, probably a year, virtually every day. And I tell you, my hair is returning to its natural color more and more.
Yeah.
It's just, it's crazy.
Yeah. No, it's what's happened to mine too. I've had several times where my hair starts to gray. I take the trace minerals because I'll be off them for a while, and then the gray reverses. I got to get on it again because I got a couple of gray hairs coming out now.
What? So it's just a balance of the minerals that your body gets out of whack, and then it produces a gray hair?
I think what it is, it's oxymelanin that causes the grain of the hair. So it's an oxidized form of melanin that is creating the grain. And when you have the minerals back in there, your body gets better at producing more pigment, and you get more pigmentation produced. Even though there's still some probably oxymelanin produced in the body, there's proportionately more healthy, normal pigment going in than not. And, I've had some people that don't reverse their gray, and that's a sign that they have more free radical damage, more oxymelanin going on than their body can overcome by just taking a trace mineral supplement. But quite a few people have reported, I'd say about 40% of the people that take Mineral Magic have had their gray hair reversed partially or completely.
And it's crazy inexpensive. What is it, $35 for a 6-month supply?
Yeah, it's super cheap.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, that's great. How do we get the mineral test that Stephen talked about?
Do you mean the urine and saliva test?
I guess, yeah. That's what you're saying.
Okay, so right now, the only way that I know to work with people that makes it so that it's accessible to most people is to, basically ask them to buy a roll of pH paper and to test their urine and saliva pHs for optimally 3 days prior to an appointment with me by phone. And that, you basically can get that pH paper from your local health food store or from our website. It's about $10 a roll for 14 feet. I think we have the best price around. And you then could measure your urine and saliva pH. You measure it between 10 a.m. and 3 p.m., at least 2 or more hours after a meal. You want to see how your body's processing food is one of the reasons that you do it 2 to 3 hours or so after a meal. And that, again, between 10 a.m. and 3 p.m., and you choose the same time every day for 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to do the 3 days. If you want to do an appointment right away and you just want 1 day of testing, we can do that and definitely get, great results, great information, and push you in the right direction. I just prefer a little bit of, more time in 3 days to see if there's something someone's doing that's skewing it 1 day and that there's a certain average going on. Because usually the body, if you're not throwing something unique into the picture, it'll stay pretty consistent, and 3 days enables me to see that consistency. And so that's the quickest, easiest way. But if somebody's really like saying, I want to put on my glasses or put on my smart cap and start studying this and figure it out for myself, well, then they would need to contact Pike Labs, and they need to order their own refractometer, their own conductivity meter, their own pH meter, and their own chemicals that to basically measure your urea levels or your urea levels in your urine. And so it gets involved, and it's probably a kit that's going to cost about $300. So that is a more complete picture. If somebody's physically living in my vicinity and can come into my office, then we can, of course, do the full chemistries on their body, and that would be the ideal. But even still, without that, I do what's called a symptom survey. So if somebody works with me remotely, they're not physically in my community, I will send them via email a health evaluation form so that we can get a full intake on each organ system's symptomology or level of strength or illness going on. And then that information, plus your overall history included in that question and answer evaluation form, plus your urine and saliva pH information, gives me a pretty good amount of information to give a person pretty good guidance on what to do.
Mm-hmm. So let's go over that, because I'm sure there are folks that will want to do the urine and saliva to see where they are, whether or not they work with you. So just go over it again. In the morning, about 3 hours or so after breakfast, you take the urine, right?
Yeah, urine and saliva at the same time.
At the same time.
Same time, yeah.
Okay.
So,
just write that down.
Yeah, you just write it down. Exactly. You got your pH paper. You spit on the pH paper. Mm-hmm. You'll see the color change. You record what color it is, or you record the number reference to the color change that happens. You got your urine specimen. You could urinate into a cup and then have it to, you know, to drip, dip your pH paper into. You see the color change. You record the number on paper, and then you do that 1 day minimum, optimally 3 days. You add those numbers together. So your urine pHs, you add the 3 days' worth together. You divide by three. You come up with an average urine pH for 3 days. Saliva pH, you add those numbers together. You divide by three. You come up with an average saliva pH for those 3 days. That is then emailed to us, and we can then know what calciums and supplementation, vitamin supplementation as well, to begin to recommend for your chemistry.
Pretty cool.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
Very awesome.
Okay, 888-663-6386. Email patrick@oneradionetwork.com. Sharon, our birthday girl, she says, tell Stephen that I do the same thing. Right when I see some gray hair, I do mineral magic and it reverses it. It's awesome. Isn't that funny?
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Sharon, she didn't take anything. So if she takes mineral magic, you know, you've made a big step. You know, she you know, I send her stuff and, yeah, she didn't take anything. Girls know what they're doing. Let's see. Is there a way to make minerals and mineral magic more absorbable? The raw whole ground rock dust of your mineral magic doesn't seem to be that absorbable. What do you mean? Is there something I can do at home to make colloidal somehow? Or what else I can do? I don't know what he means by absorbable. You mean in the water?
No, he's probably saying that basically... his understanding or her understanding is basically that when it's not in a suspended liquid state, like a colloidal state in water, that the body's not going to have optimum assimilation of it, which is, you know, the common understanding. But in reality, it's different than that because in your intestinal tract lining, you know, you have a bunch of microorganisms. And one of the things that people are not realizing when they talk about mineral supplementation is the idea that they think that, okay, well, if it's not a protein-bound or an amino acid chelate, that your body's not going to absorb it at all and or very well. And it's much different than that in my experience. In the same way that you have cow manure you put into the garden you know, becomes full of this cow manure and the beneficial bacteria from the cow manure's feces is now in the soil, and those same bacteria then participate in the digestion of the minerals in the soil and making them available to the plants. And it's no different for the human GI tract. You've got beneficial bacteria in your gut that know how to chelate minerals and make them available to your body. That's one mechanism of absorption. There's actual just direct, you know, provided the mineral particles are small enough and the body can utilize them, they'll just absorb them in their state without prior chelation. And that's basically what you talk – this is called electrochemistry, where you're no longer just dealing with, okay, is this a mineral being attached to a protein in some way, shape, or form? It may not be doing that. It may just be interreacting in the chemistry of the body so that once it's in the bloodstream, because – energy, part of the energy production of the body is the interaction of anions and cations. So acidic substances with alkaline substances, they interreact, and there's more energy created from that interreaction. Just like if you took, you know, some kind of alkaline substance like baking soda and you added citric acid to it, there's a chemical reaction between an acid and an alkaline that creates a release of electrical energy. So that's exactly what goes on in the body as well when you do mineral supplements in this form, like just a pure metallic mineral. And to substantiate that this works, you just look at the Hunza people who are a long-lived, healthy people that are consuming this glacial milk in their diet, which is pure rock minerals, you know, glaciers that have ground down the sides of mountains, and the glaciers melt, and they bring this mineral silt into the water, and the mineral silt is so rich that the water is opaque white. It's so high in calcium that the amount of calcium they're consuming daily is the equivalent of 1/4 cup of pure rock calcium powder, and along with trace minerals. And these people are 100 to 120 and sometimes up to 140 years without any disease in terms of their lifespan. And then you go to the Okinawan Japanese, and they are one of the longest-lived industrialized cultures where they eat tons of coral calcium in their diet and have for generations, which is calcium carbonate, pure rock calcium. And their electrochemistry is so well maintained that they know little to no cancer or disease and live 80 and beyond free of disease.
Wow. So, I don't know. Why can't we just go out and get a half gallon of Borden's milk and we'd be good?
Well, as plain devil's advocate that you are on this question, because Borden's milk is... that's a good question. I'm going to lead into another answer, though.
Okay,
so Borden's milk is, of course, or any milk, is dealing with a pasteurization process. When you heat the milk up to the 161 degrees and you destroy, you could say, or you bend and twist proteins and you break the bonds and or the calcium connection to the proteins, there is now an alteration of the bioavailability of those minerals in terms of the cell's uptake. And when you look at the studies done on, you know, farm animals with raw milk versus pasteurized milk, the cows that are raised on the pasteurized milk show bloated bellies, unhealthy body development, and the cows raised on the raw milk end up showing very healthy body development and no bloated belly. And then when you slaughter the animals and you see the organ difference is vast. The liver of the pasteurized milk cow is very tan, yellow, or a brownish color, whereas the liver color of the raw milk-fed cow is very dark, red, brown, copper-colored. That's very healthy. And so your organ system's health is dependent upon this mineral availability. Literally, the color of your organs internally varies according to how available minerals are to it. So the cow's milk that's pasteurized is inferior to the cow's milk that's raw. And then if it's raw, you've still got the casein issue that you're dealing with, which so many people today have casein intolerances, even in raw milk. So anyways, milk just ends up being a problem for a lot of people. However, for those people that tolerate milk, there's this whole thing of, like, you know, cottage cheese and flax oil or hemp oil, which Joanna Budwig came up with. And when you study this, you'll find out that studies show that calcium ions, when they're deficient, when you do cancer cell studies, cancer cells grow in a low calcium environment and cannot grow or don't grow as well in a high calcium environment. So this is my realization when I learned this, is that basically this is why the Budwig diet works, is because for those people that can tolerate cottage cheese, you're addressing, one, a concentrated calcium source from the cottage cheese and somewhat, I think, some of the sulfur amino acids is there. And two is the flax oil is giving you the linoleic acid omega-3 that the cell walls need, that they're deficient in, so they can absorb oxygen better. So when you increase oxygenation, which cancer can't grow in that environment, you increase calcium levels, cancer can't grow in that environment, you've just introduced two nutritional conditions that are counteractive to cancer.
Wow. Stephen Heuer is with us. We're going to do just a quick little break, and then when I get back, we're going to ask Stephen about what's the difference between calcium we're talking about and the calcium that can actually show up on the inside of your arteries and doesn't let the blood go blink, 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 bloop, 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 that kind of thing. And you can actually do tests for, they have CT scans. You can go out and do a CT scan, which we don't recommend because it has buku x-rays and actually will tell you how much calcium you have in your arteries. So what's that calcium doing there? That is coming up after I press this button. Okay, Stephen Heuer, he is Synergistic Nutrition Guy, Nutripath, and the man behind the One World Whey. Chocolate vanilla strawberry and unsweetened, unflavored. That's my fave. Of course, you have better taste than me. Probably do strawberry. What's your favorite, Stephen?
Chocolate.
Oh, I knew you were a chocolate guy. I don't know why I knew
you. Like it plain, huh?
I do. I just do. But I put colostrum in it, you know. I do colostrum in One World Whey. That's my favorite way to do it.
What else do you mix with it? Anything?
That's about it. I, you know, my body, it's really interesting. I get emails from people, and they build these smoothies, right? There's about 15 ingredients. If I did that, I'd be on the couch for about a day. I don't know. Can you do a lot of different ingredients at once?
Well, I don't, it depends on what they are, but I don't. I keep it. I don't put like a lot of fat in it or anything like that. I mean,
yeah. Of course, colostrum has its share of fat, but every now and then I'll do a shot of MCT oil, but I got to keep it pretty simple. I don't know why. I'm a delicate guy. You know, I still cry at Sleepless in Seattle when I watch it. So I'm just sensitive.
Oh, yeah.
I'm a sensitive kind of guy.
I'm the same way.
All right.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Definitely emotionally sensitive, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's a very interesting interesting subject you all talking about. Distilled water, writes Marcia, have had this conversation with friends who are mostly opposed to distilled water. The great herbalist Dr. Christopher also promoted distilled water to cleanse the body. Oh, yeah. He was also a vegetarian. Thanks for an interesting show. Well, you're welcome.
All right. Thank you. Yeah.
We'll make your head explode. You guys could try to figure it out. But I was one of those, boy, I really thought the distilled water was like the devil for years. I don't know why. I really did.
Yeah.
I don't know.
We've all been programmed to believe certain things because of, information that's passed around as fact, and it's really more hearsay and not fact.
Mm-hmm. But I do often wonder about the whole God thing. I mean, if distilled water is so good, as the saying goes, how come we're not born with a distiller?
Well, you're talking about looking at the God in the whole picture. God makes water that way. The hydrological
I see. Rain is distilled water.
It's the whole process of making rainwater. If we, did not have the pollution in the atmosphere and all the stuff, then rainwater is an ideal water to drink, for sure. And look at how wonderfully happy plants are every time they're rained upon, how well they do.
Yeah. Oh, boy. Yeah, I'll tell you. How does Stephen recommend using the Mineral Magic product? Should I drink it with distilled water? Should I take it with meals or an empty stomach?
Either way, it'll work. I mean, I personally like to do supplementation, minerals with meals.
Mm-hmm.
And seems to be, nature designed us to do, you could say, minerals coexisting with food. And so I'm keeping in harmony with that particular rhythm. I've done it the other way, too, and it's still worked. But it seems like my stomach sort of goes, there's no food in here. This doesn't feel quite right if I do it just with on an empty stomach. So I do it with food mostly.
On the intuitive level, I get emails from people that say, I don't know, and it's kind of happening to me right now over the past month. I just look at meat or chicken or steak, or really grass fed or lamb or something, and it just kind of sits in there. I got to freeze it before it goes bad. I'm not attracted to it right now. What do you know? What's going on in the body? What's your theory? And I've had other emails where people they go through stages with meat or meat mainly animal foods. What's your theory on that?
Yeah, that's what ends up happening. It's like in my experience, exactly the same thing.
Really?
I go through that period of like, okay, my body's ravenous. I eat the protein for a while, the salmon or the lamb or the grass fed beef, and then all of a sudden, after a few days of that, my body's saying, nope, stop. And I go, I have no appetite for
nothing.
It. Days and days and days.
Wow.
And what's going on is that we're not designed to eat these high amounts of protein. So what ends up happening is that you get a lot of the nitrogen salts that I was talking about. And these nitrogen salts are getting excessive in the system. They will thicken the blood. Anytime you have excessive urea levels and salt levels, your blood will thicken. You cannot carry oxygen as well. Your body starts to feel unhealthy. It puts pressure on your heart, and it creates the high blood pressure scenario if this is happening for a prolonged period of time.
Right.
And for people that are like instinctive and intuitive like you and me and others who are just basically listening clearly, then they basically cycle on the proteins and cycle off the proteins. One, they need them because they're not producing protein efficiently because of this calcium mineral deficiency going on in the body. The liver can't produce the albumin protein. So at some point of this semi-vegetarian program that their body's on, they get to the point where their liver is all of a sudden ready to make use of protein in higher amounts because they've let their body get rid of these urea compounds and the salts, and now the body's back to cannibalizing its own protein structures, and it's back to feed me protein. So you go back to eating your meats and your fish and whatever. But in essence, it's a constant up and down pattern and never kind of a consistent thing because the key missing piece is the calciums and the trace minerals, where when you have those, your body's appetite for protein should go down. I've experienced that, and so have others. And then you become more able to live on more vegetarian foods for longer times, need less concentrated amounts, less quantity amounts of actual animal proteins, but you know your body's still going to call for it, need it, but just not in much abundance.
Sure. And then you know when nobody's looking, you could always just write out to your favorite Mickey D's, you know, and pony up, you know. Give me one of those triple whopper doodles. Just kidding. That's really interesting. And if you look too traditionally, Stephen, I think isn't it kind of sort of true? I believe, but I don't know where I get this that. Whatever, long time ago, and even the farmers and all that, they didn't eat meat every day, did they?
No.
I mean, people didn't, really. They couldn't even afford it, I don't think.
It's like the cow on the farm was more important for milk production than for meat.
Yeah.
And to, you know, raise an animal, all of my reading on diet for humans over many years, on many books, tells me that grains, the reason that grains were called the staff of life was because they formed the core of the diet, whether that
core.
Be Europe with wheat, barley, or rye, mm-hmm. or whether that be Asian countries where it was rice, or you go to, you know, the Polynesian countries and it's tubers or whatever, that starches formed a principal part of the diet. It's a more easily combustible fuel source. And the fact that starches have got such a bad rap.
Boy, they really have. And grains and starch, they need a good PR person these days.
Yeah, well, the whole thing gets down to basically agriculture again and getting back to, with wheat, you know, that I'm really glad you had that lady.
The einkorn?
Yeah, the einkorn, because that is one of the most wonderful, wonderful reintroductions of wheat in a form that a lot of people with gluten intolerance will not have a problem with. And their bodies will thrive on it and burn carbohydrate efficiently into energy. And when you realize the whole picture, you know, all these cultures, they would eat the grain, they'd eat some vegetables,
mm-hmm.
and maybe a small amount of animal product, but just small amounts. If you go to Asian countries, just like I guess the China study kind of indicated this, it's like small amounts of animal products. You know, you've got a little bit of shrimp or seafood or, you know, pork or beef cut up in this soup that's mostly grains and vegetables.
And then
you look at the Asian cultures, they're superior. I mean, they've flooded our country and they have the highest levels of intelligence compared to Americans because they've been living on their ancestral diets, which is grains, vegetables, and small amounts of animal products in the mix that makes for a much more balanced chemistry, a much healthier brain.
So I guess the grains are getting a really get hit hard these days because maybe the quality of the grains that people are eating and why they're not doing well on them, you think?
Well, plus it's also the grains are being blamed for 4, 5, 6 decades of people living an unconscious diet where they've allowed themselves to consume alcohol, refined white sugar, cooked and or processed oxidized vegetable oils, MSG in the food supply that's become rampant in all refined processed foods in the form of natural flavor, and all these factors, high fructose corn syrup, their soda pops they've drank for decades at a time, and then all of a sudden they've got these health issues and they start converting over and they've got obesity problems or weight problems and they are going, well, my body can't handle carbs, I gain this weight. Well, that's because you've damaged your own blood sugar regulation, your adrenal function, you've got high cortisol, and all these other myriad factors that play into this, you know, having love handles and having a belly and too much fat on your thighs.
Sure.
It's not the carbs that are originally the problem. Carbs can be included in the diet. I think that they're essential to not stressing your body with excess nitrogen wastes. When you look at the other side of the picture, the Atkins diet, you're stressing your body with high amounts of nitrogen waste that will thicken your blood, that will create a propensity for hardening of the arteries, high blood pressure, congestive heart failure, and the consequent early death from that. So when you look at your overall physical health and electrochemistry and the amount of energy you produce in a day, it's going to be far easier for the human engine to keep carbs in the diet and to remineralize your system with the calciums and the trace elements, get the distilled water in the picture, so that your body can efficiently burn the excess fat off through a natural pattern of having healthier body and higher metabolism.
So, and I guess, too, you kind of got to keep in mind, I think, about when people talk about carbs eaten over the last, 50 years, they're throwing things like Dunkin' Donuts and cookies and cakes and crackers and and bread from the, you know, from the Safeway and all that into the picture, and just denatured pasta and whatever, right? I mean, hybridized wheat and they're throwing all that into the mix, and it's not a fair comparison.
No, and when you study how grains were used in the past, I mean, my reading on this tells me and taught me that, you know, one of the reasons that the Roman soldier or the Roman army was one of the reasons it was so successful in conquering different territories back in the era of the Roman Empire was because they relied on wheat as the staple to feed their soldiers.
Yeah.
And the soldiers were reported to have said or chronicled in their biographies or autobiography or whatever, their journals, that they had more endurance and energy on wheat than they did on meat. And they could march all day and they could still then fight at the end of the day and conquer their foes or their whatever because of their fueled by that. And that's exactly one of the reasons why supposedly Alexander the Great married Cleopatra and made that happen was because they wanted the Nile Delta to become a part of the property of the Roman Empire to produce the highest quality wheat to feed their soldiers.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought because she was just a hottie.
Sure,
probably both, yeah. Probably both, too. Isn't that fast? And I had also, I think, read or heard that there were times, or maybe a lot, that they just gave the Roman soldiers the wheat kernels, and they just ate them. I don't even think they cooked. I don't even think they cooked them.
I heard that they ate it raw as either, I guess, grain or as a powdered meal. That's what I heard.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know, I want to get some of those Icorn. Oh, I bought some of the Icorn wheat berries, you know, from that ancient wheat.
Yeah.
And I thought it'd be fun to sprout those and maybe have a little cereal or something. I don't know. There's things you can do with that.
I was thinking of that too, Patrick. I almost soaked some last night, and I said, "Oh, I'm not going to do it just yet. I'll do it another day." But I have the same thought.
Yeah. I sprout them up. Oh, I don't know. I want to tell you my sourdough Einkorn bread experience. So I make the sourdough starter with the Einkorn flour, and I put it in the fridge for about a week or so, and then when you pull it out of the fridge, you have to fresh it up, right? You got to add the flour and the water and get it happy and bubbling. Well, I didn't do that. I just did it, and I didn't get it all bubbly like I should have. Carla said I should have done it two or three times when it's been in the fridge that long. And then I made the bread, and I just couldn't get it to do anything, man. It just lay there. It just lay there and looked at me and said, no, I ain't moving. And I finally said, I got tired after about a week of playing with it, and I made it, and it came out an incredible rock. It was like a rock. And I'm going to put it outside and let the deer just kind of lick on it, you know. Maybe they'll get some nutrients. So that's my first Einkorn bread experience, but I'm going to do better.
I've been doing the yeasted version.
Oh, you've been, and is it good?
It's delicious. It's so quick. In 2 hours, I've got myself, you know, I just did 2 loaves of this Einkorn wheat bread with yeast, and I love it. It's so delicious.
Isn't it tasty?
It's a chewy bread that's like I got body to it. It's so satisfying.
Well, I just may surrender for a moment and do the yeast thing just so I can have some of the bread until I figure out the sourdough.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. John says, how does one learn about his or her own optimal body chemistry? That's a great question. How does one learn about their own optimal body chemistry?
Well, this is where you get into reading some textbooks on this. But basically, there's Dr. Bedeau is Beddoe. Is a dentist that converted his, I guess, scientific focus over to nutritional science over the last 30 plus years to basically chronicling the work of Dr. Kerry Reams.
Mm-hmm.
And so Dr. Kerry Reams that pioneered these revelations of both soil, animal, and human nutritional science, he basically took that information of Dr. Reams, worked with him directly, and then recorded all of this and put it into textbook format. So you'd have to get with him to read the books on this that he's produced. AdvancedIdealsInstitute.org is the place to buy those books, AdvancedIdeals.org. And then you could actually get this knowledge, this education about the correct electrochemistry based on Dr. Kerry Reams' work.
And why are you so high or confident of Kerry Reams' work? How did you get to that point?
Because I have tried the biological terrain assessment method, which is saying that our ideal pHs are 7 to 7.4 in our saliva, and our urine should be somewhat acidic, but it's the saliva is the most important, and it should be in the alkaline range. And I did that for many, many years, and I could be in the alkaline range for days and days, weeks and weeks, just from supplementation and from diet, and I never felt my best. And then, and I've done that for years, and I used to promote that teaching because that's what's taught by most people. And I've had other people be in those pH ranges, and they're not healthy. I mean, I've worked with raw food vegetarians, and the problem that I saw with raw food vegetarians was that they always had, they would eventually have gum recession and cavities and end up or losing teeth because they did not have the correct calcium electrochemistry on the raw vegetarian diet, and their body will then suck the calcium out of the bones and consequently cause gum recession and dental decay and tooth loss. And that was chronic. I've seen this time and again. Hmm. They've got really nice complexions, healthy-looking people in some respects, but then they're deteriorating on the inside. And then I've done the meat diet thing where, you know, your body tends to be more acidic because of the animal byproducts. And that created a negative chemistry. The saliva could still be alkaline if I supplemented correctly, but the urine would be more acidic. But I didn't feel good that way either. My nervous system was always irritated. There, I have a tendency towards insomnia, and when I was doing the raw meat diet, that would be exacerbated, which later I found that's because of the high amount of animal protein. You're producing such high levels of nitrate nitrogen and ammonia nitrogen as a byproduct and nitrogen salts, that these nitrogen salts are irritating your nervous system so that you cannot rest well. And this is a common problem I saw when Ogenus was doing his thing and teaching that whole raw meat thing. So, and working with just tons of people. So I've seen that. Then I do this particular protocol that I was introduced to with the Kerry Reams work, and it's more thorough understanding that I now have. And all of a sudden, voila, I feel better. My energy is better. I have more consistent energy. My body seems stronger muscularly, like my liver is doing a better job at protein synthesis. And then lo and behold, my elimination is better than it's been in 38 years. Like now my intestinal tract and liver are doing a much better job than they ever did.
38 years. Wow. That's something. Here's Paul writes, as someone with rheumatoid arthritis, where would I start with minerals and such? Where would he start?
First important thing he needs is the distiller. If he could get the electron 4 or electron 5 distiller and start making that kind of water, that would be the most important first step because that's a lifetime investment when you buy that. I mean, that's
How expensive are they?
$1,500 for the electron 4 and $2,500 for the electron 5.
Wow.
And they are well worth it.
Really?
You know, that's a piece of equipment that is more powerful than anything I own.
That's crazy expensive, though. I wish that stuff wasn't so expensive, but I guess it is what it is, right?
Yeah, but if it's a lifetime investment and it's like a person investing in a high-quality computer is going to be spending $1,000 or more.
Sure, sure.
This is like that, and you're going to have it for the rest of your life. It's very, very economical when you string it out over decades of usage. But basically that water goes in, and it starts to detoxify his body of the salts that are creating the arthritis in his joints and the inflammation and the damage. And also this other thing is the synovial fluid production in the joints that are supposed to be there for your lubrication and your mobility. Well, if you're chronically too rich in these protein salts in your system, you're going to pull the synovial fluid out you're not going to produce as much because your body needs that fluid material and or any fluid material to dilute the irritation effects of the salts. And so from a standpoint of improving synovial fluid production and from a standpoint of removing the direct irritation to the joints, the distilled water is the first step.
So barring getting the super-duper califragilistic one, at least get a just distilled water.
At least get distilled water.
Exactly. And then where would he go after that, arthritis fellow?
And then after that, I'd get him on there are several things. Basically, the Synergy one that you take that you love so much.
I love it.
Synergy one is a miraculous product.
Tell folks what that is. It's just crazy.
It's a product that can – it's a homeopathic formula designed to raise the growth factor levels in the human body. And by growth factors, there's an array of different protein compounds the body produces in higher amounts when you're younger that are involved in commanding your cells to absorb amino acids to create proteins. The rate at which you make protein is the rate at which you are staying young or aging. If you make proteins faster, you're staying younger because you're repairing faster. If you're making proteins too slow, you're aging. So these growth factors control that. That's why when people take shots of growth hormone or testosterone or whatever, there's an increase in protein synthesis and an increase in the repair rate of the body. So when you take Synergy 1, you're helping to homeopathically nurture your body to produce these growth factors, and the consequent result is that you can produce more of the proteins that heal your joints or your liver or your bones or your gums reversing gum recession or any number of different factors, because every structure in your body is a protein-based structure. So we've had miracle after miracle take place with that product for the last 15 years. And so I would get them on that, and that would be a way to support the regeneration of the body and the joints. I would get them on there's different ways to sort of supply the body with proteins that might fuel the repair of the joints. One of them is a green lip muscle product that we carry, and that just happens to have the nice mucopolysaccharide proteins that are needed to repair the joints, and people have reported success with arthritis using that. And then also hyaluronic acid, Synthobial 7 is the product name. Synthobial 7 is a way to supplement the body with the direct material, hyaluronic acid, that supports synovial fluid production, which is the lubrication material in the joints. Those things would probably help him symptom-wise probably pretty quickly in the first 30 days to have improvement and reduction of pain. And then the overall bigger picture of, like, you know, remodeling the joints, getting rid of any calcium deposits in the joints, that all is going to take place over time as that person gets the calciums in the picture, the trace minerals, starts to correct their diet from being excessive in proteins, and then supports the immune system in remodeling the joints. So there's more to it after the consultation. I'd get them on other products.
Sure, sure. Well, the Synergy one he talked about, it's a little spray bottle. I had about 3 sprays this morning. I love this product. You can get that. The Mineral Magic and the One World Whey and all the other products that Stephen talked about, and even that super-duper expensive investment in the distiller. If you click on any of the One World Whey ads on the front page of OneRadioNetwork.com, the One World Whey ad, and then click on and then get any of these products that Stephen is talking about. Let's take this call, Mr. Heuer. What's your first name? Where are you calling from?
Yes, this is Robert in Houston, gentlemen. Wonderful show. You got me all psyched up.
Yeah,
about.
He got you all psyched up, Robert.
Hi, Robert.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. What's up?
I like what I got to tell myself a lot of time what old Dr. Gary Gordon said. He said, I'm expensive to keep alive.
Yes, Gary Gordon's good at that.
Okay, arsenic, lead. First of all, I'm a big mineral taker, powdered minerals, one similar to yours. I haven't had the opportunity to try yours yet. But let me say this, arsenic, lead, mercury, palladium, cadmium, gladninium, and probably 20 others, they're listed as in Mineral Magic.
Yes.
I've never understood, you know, a little bit of poison's good or something, so what's the deal with that? I know you can't get that stuff out, so how is it that we can get our mind around taking mercury, lead, arsenic, although it's in small amounts, and it's in Mineral Magic?
The way we get our mind around it is that, one is that we just observe in nature that the product is causing plants and animals and humans to thrive on it. So regardless of our current, you could say, intellectual understanding of things, it works. Two is that if you look at kelp and you do assays of different kinds of kelp, they also have mercury and toxic metals in them as well. And yet kelp is a nutritive food that does nothing but benefit the body for someone that, you know, doesn't have a direct allergy to it. Sodium alginate that's in it that binds heavy metals, it pulls radioactive isotopes out of the body, plus it yields and provides iodine and trace minerals that the body can benefit from that as well. If you look at agriculture in general, aluminum is the most abundant mineral in the Earth's crust, and it's abundant in soil in general, and therefore there's always trace amounts of aluminum in most vegetables, whether that's broccoli or carrots or whatever. And yet the body is not being toxified by it or being damaged by it. And so there's all these things in nature which basically show us that as it exists in nature in trace amounts, we are not being created problems with it. My intellectual comprehension of why that is would be, one, the minerals are bound up. They're kind of like they're clusters. They're molecules. So say the mercury is bound to phosphorus and or zinc or copper or any other manganese, magnesium, whatever. It's bound up to some other element or cluster of elements. And the body intelligently, instinctively, in terms of in the villi of your intestinal tract, can discern what it needs and doesn't need and doesn't necessarily want to absorb it and or it's not bioavailable. The other intellectual, you know, approach that I have on that is that when trace elements are in balance with toxic metals and they're there only in parts per billion, that sort of balanced chemistry is that such that there's a quantitative overall benefit to the body so that the body can selectively just detoxify that little bit of mercury, lead, or arsenic, or galladium out without any consequence to it at all because it's there in such small amounts, and you've just upregulated the body's ability to make glutathione and phase one liver detoxification enzymes by taking mineral magic and making these minerals available so that you can produce the detox chemicals. So that little bit of toxicity doesn't even end up having any negative effect because you just can get rid of it easily.
Great answer. And also, I guess another way, what I was just thinking while you were talking is, even though that word mercury and aluminum's on that page, I guess you can go by parts per million. Have you ever had that measured? And is it such an infinitesimal amount that they have to list it, but it's like 00, you know,
yeah,
what I mean? Did you ever measure the mercury in there?
Exactly. It's there because it's in there in parts per, not million, parts per billion. So it's just there in super insignificant amounts. And that's the same with the kelp that I mentioned earlier. Assays of kelp show that too, like parts per billion mercury in kelp. Yet people eat kelp all the time.
I think too, you could analyze a good sea salt, all the different, you know, Celtic or whatever, all the Himalayan. And I think you have all those things in there too, don't you? Mercury, aluminum, all of them.
Yeah, I think that you do. I think that some of these companies don't necessarily put them on there, maybe because the FDA doesn't require it if it isn't there in certain amounts.
Yeah.
But that they do it so that people's minds are placated to. But I think that, yes, it's there in our supplement world much more than people realize, but they don't have to put it there because it's not required, perhaps.
Yeah, maybe. Up to a certain amount.
Yeah, you just breathe and you probably get it in. It's just whenever I see those words listed on there, I'm like, yikes.
Yeah,
having had mercury poisoning myself, I've had the ultimate, you could say, paranoia around mercury and heavy metals for a number of years. And so, but one of the ways that I sort of like ally that is just to recognize that, oh my gosh, this has been helping animals and humans and plants miraculously for decades and decades, and I've benefited from it. So, irregardless of my intellectual understanding, I go with my intuitional awareness of results.
Okay, Robert.
How much mineral magic do you take a day?
I go on and off of it, but when I do take it, it's about a half teaspoon a day.
Mm-hmm.
When you say on and off, day on or week off or month or how?
Right now I'm doing MinCol and my other calciums, and so I'm getting some of my trace mineral needs met with that, and I'm taking the Ormus elements. I carry some minerals that exist in their single atomic state called Ormus, which has a direct positive effect on the rate at which electrons flow through your body, and so you get a physical cognitive improvement. Your mental sharpness improves, your sense of well-being improves, and so I'm relying on that somewhat for my trace minerals as well. And those are much more expensive than mineral magic, but they're much more noticeable in their effect on the nervous system. So I don't feel the need for the mineral magic at this time. That's just where I'm at.
Yeah, as usual, it's good to rotate. Well, thank you, guys.
You're quite welcome, Robert. Good questions.
Thank you, Robert.
Here's an email from Sharita. Does Stephen have a protocol for a weight loss and building muscle with One World Whey?
Yeah, I do. Basically, it's a combination of things. I mean, the weight loss thing is a combination of factors. As I said before, you could have these salt levels built up in your system that are actually retained in the abdomen and fatty tissue, causing you to continue to have that weight there until you can remove those acid salt, those toxic salts out of the system. That's one factor, and the other is just toxins in general in the fatty tissue needs to be neutralized to help the body say, okay, it's safe to get rid of this fat now because it doesn't have to be a storage reservoir for toxins anymore or for salts. That's one factor. So cleaning up your diet 100% and One World Whey will help you. Also, consuming the distilled water will help you. But in terms of actual practical caloric things, I found that you need to take supplemental amino acids. We have a product called Myothon. So you do like 2 to 3, to, depending on your body size, up to 5 tablets of Myothon, say in the morning and again at noon, and you go more towards a vegetarian diet, more raw fruits, vegetables, grains, nuts, and seeds, and you do more vegetable juices, and you do your One World Whey as your protein source, say at noon, you know, that's one time, and then, you know, at dinner you can do whatever satisfies you there, whether it's fish or whatever, and you basically need less calories when you do the amino acids. So you do the Myothon, and you stabilize your blood sugar for prolonged periods of time, and your brain says, well, when the blood sugar is stable like this, I don't need excess body fat reserve energy, so my metabolism picks up and you start to burn excess body fat. So I like to use Myothon. I like to use the Synergy 1, because Synergy 1 improves your sleep, and it helps your adrenals to recover more, so that during the day you have better energy from better adrenal energy. You actually can directly support burning of fat for fuel with Synergy 1. So Synergy 1 at night and in the morning, Myothon, also the trace elements, you know, Mineral Magic or something more sophisticated like what I'm doing will help to make it so your body cellularly and nervous system-wise is fed so that the hidden hunger goes away. You're not continually feeling hungry despite having a belly full of food, because your brain is recognizing the presence of nutrients from the minerals that makes it feel satiated. So you've got the trace minerals, Mineral Magic, the Synergy 1, the Myothon, along with your One World Whey once or twice a day as a protein source. And, you know, clean, healthy, not vegetarian completely, but more vegetarian diet will help you to move towards losing unwanted body fat. And there are more sophisticated ways of doing it than what I just said, but that's a real, you could say, get it started today type program that will work.
Stephen Heuer, Patrick Timpone, wrapping things up, 21 September 2015. I was going to ask about the calcium in the arteries, and I forgot, but I wrote it down. So how does the calcium get into the arteries and clog things up?
When your body chemistry is, like I said, either too acid or too alkaline, so we call that the electrochemistry being out of range, then these excessive salts start to store in your arteries and start to create the calcification that we talked about. That's that's a direct result of that and also free radical damage on the lining of the arteries, creating the inflammation, causing the body to want to protect itself by strengthening the weakened blood vessel wall by putting calcium and cholesterol down, because that's reinforcing the weak artery. Those are two reasons why, and that the reversal of the plaque in the arteries isn't deprivation of calcium. If that were the case, then Okinawan Japanese and the Hunzas would have the highest levels of plaque in their arteries than anybody, and they don't. They don't have any. So you just go back to what's observed in nature and what humans have done already successfully, and you realize, okay, you know, we have to get back to this better electrochemistry by reducing our animal protein intake, drinking more distilled water, distilled water to get rid of these salts, and the body will naturally reverse the plaque buildup over time with the proper diet and supplementation.
But the calcium-cholesterol combo is the body doing what it needs to do because it doesn't want to spring a leak.
Yeah, it doesn't want to spring a leak, and it's also making sure that if there's a roughness because of the damage to the arterial lining, if that's causing blood, the platelet factors in the blood to want to be triggered into a blood clotting effect, then the body's ensuring that blood clotting effect doesn't happen by creating a smooth surface over which blood can flow. So it's protective in its, you could say, response to whatever you did that caused that damage to your artery or the electrochemistry of your body being out of whack and causing calcium deposits to occur because you're, you know, too acidic or too alkaline.
And there's a lot of reasons why the arteries can get inflamed and the calcium cholesterol team goes to work. Many reasons.
Huh? Yeah, there's. I mean, one of them is homogenized milk.
Yeah.
Another one is cooked vegetable oils. Free radical generating effects of vegetable oils are really bad. Chlorine in the drinking water or exposed in our bodies in any way, shape, or form damages the lining of the arteries. Cigarette smoking damages the lining of the arteries. And I based on, you know, all this that I've read, alcohol consumption contributes to the dehydration process, which leads to a hardening of the arteries, not necessarily an immediate plaque accumulation, but a damaging to the cardiovascular system.
And then the we've heard over the years, Stephen, when the blood sugar gets too cattywampus, then the insulin circulates too, and that can also damage arteries, huh? Insulin?
Well, the liver ends up producing a lot of triglycerides as a result of the excess sugar floating around.
Uh-huh.
And then that triglycerides basically contributes to sticky blood. And you also, at that point, your LDL cholesterol becomes, it's supposed to chaperone around healthy linolenic and linoleic acid, unsaturated fatty acids throughout the body for the cell walls to be using it and benefit from it. But when you're using oxidized vegetable oils in the diet, your LDL cholesterol will then chaperone around an oxidized form of the linolenic or linoleic acids, which then becomes a free radical generating, plaque generating type of LDL cholesterol.
Oh, I knew that. Just kidding. Good job, Stephen. Well, I had fun. Did you have fun?
I did. I thoroughly.
Well, I know. Well, I know you love talking about this, and I don't know how you remember all this stuff, man. Just my, you know, I have to wrap my head with duct tape just to, like we do with Adam Bergstrom. Good job, Stephen. So, folks, let's just wrap up. All of the products that you talked about are available through your site, through our website on the One World Whey ad on One Radio Network. And then if folks would like to talk to you, how do they contact you if they want to, like, have a private consultation?
864-895-6250. 864-895-6250. You'll talk to one of my staff. They'll set up a time. They'll make sure you get some pH paper or you're educated to get some and take your pHs, and we'll set you on the calendar and work with you as soon as possible.
864-895-6250?
Yes.
And that's in
South Carolina.
South
Greenville,
Carolina.
Greenville area, South Carolina. Yeah.
South Carolina.
Yeah.
Is it pretty there?
It's beautiful. Yeah. It's one of the reasons they call it Greenville is because it's like
it's so
Hawaii.
Green.
We get so much rain that it stays green all the time.
I'll come visit sometime. Stephen, thanks a lot. You're a good friend. And
thanks, Patrick.
Appreciate your research. And take care. We'll see you next month, huh?
All right. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Stephen Heuer. There you go.